This is Eddie Hearn, Matchroom Boxing. You're watching Sporting Icons. You don't need to be anywhere else.
Well, everyone, I've got an absolute legend on the phone in the name of Barry Hearn. How are you, mate?
I'm always well, mate. Good to talk to you.
And you. So, first of all, I mean, welcome back to boxing, albeit briefly, yesterday.
Yeah, but I think that was a cameo performance, wasn't it? Due to a severe labour shortage of people that know what they're talking about, they had to rope in the old man.
Yeah. Did it bring back memories?
Oh, it was fun. I enjoyed it. I always enjoy telling the truth, you know. It's refreshing. Yeah. As you get older, you tend to tell the truth more because, of course, you can't remember lies as well when you get older, so you've got to be careful.
Yeah,
that is
true.
But no, it was good. Good to see some old faces there and some people I respect, and enjoyed it. Enjoyed the banter.
Yeah. Well, one of my things when I spoke about the press conference, like one of the things that you said, which I applaud you for, was the whole WBC Dillian White thing. I mean, they have done him dirty, haven't they?
I think so. I mean, I think they've, I don't know why. Perhaps he's run over Maurizio Sullivan's cat or something and hasn't told him. But
well, it's not a PBC fight, is it?
He really should have been number one 15 months ago, you know. I mean, overlooked and then ordered to fight Brazil, and then suddenly Brazil gets the mandatory above him, and Dillian, I think, all respect to Dillian, he's a proper mature man now, you know. He's taken it in his stride, he believes in his own ability, and he's going to keep active and keep pushing his case, and we all certainly do that on his behalf as well, because I think he deserves to be an immediate mandatory for Deontay Wilder should he get past Brazil.
I totally agree with that, and I mean, I've had Dillian on the channel several times. And I mean, we always talk about all he wants to do is fight. And like when I spoke to Eddie last time, he was up here in Newcastle. Even he said that he has to save Dillian from himself, as in he'll fight anyone for a tenner on the cobbles. So he's almost got to like guide him at times.
Well, I'm not sure he'd fight for that type of person anymore. But he doesn't mess about. I mean, it's really he's a decent fighter. He's a live opponent, you know. And when you've got a lot to lose, like your mandatory number one position or whatever that's coming for him, you know, I think he represents a risk, and I think Dillian's to be applauded for that because he's backing himself, you know, as he's done his whole career, really.
Yeah.
I mean, he has in the past, you know, fought for very reasonable purses because it was the right fight at the right time in his career. And you know, these fighters today are a lot more sensible, a lot more balanced, business-like people. Yeah. And Dillian, I've been impressed with him. I think he's taking the right career move, and he's going to give the public a lot of entertainment.
No, I totally agree. And his fight with Oscar Rivas is no joke, is it?
Oh, it's a tough one. Oscar Rivas is an athlete. He's a proper fighter. Mm. You know, he's coming out of a very tough environment. His last win was impressive. You know, people sometimes mistake records. They don't tell you everything because you don't know what a fighter's capable of until he's been tested. And I don't think Rivas has really been that tested against any of the big names, but that doesn't mean to say he's not capable when he is tested. So I think we're in for fireworks on July the 20th at the O2.
I totally agree. And the undercard looking pretty good so far. And you guys won't just...
Well, Dave Allen and Pricey, David Pricey, I mean, that's one of the best undercard fights I can think of, because I have no idea what's going to happen.
They're both
such nice guys, and you know, coming at different stages potentially of their career, but both with ambition, both believe they can still, you know, climb the ladder of heavyweights, and it's a great time to be a heavyweight boxer because of the amount of money flying around. I said it yesterday, it's not that I don't care who wins or loses, I just like them both, and whoever wins, great, and they'll go forward. And I still think there's life in whoever loses as well, because heavyweight action seems to be where it's at the moment. And these blokes give value. They give value to the punter who buys a ticket. You have no idea what is going to happen. You know, Pricey can bang, really bang.
Yeah, yeah.
Dave Allen can take a shot, and as he showed with Lucas Brown, he's capable of inflicting some pain himself, you know.
Yeah.
Both have got vulnerability. I said yesterday that they went to university, they'd have a master's degree in vulnerability. But in a way, that's what makes it so exciting. You don't know what you're going to get. And I can't wait for it soon. I think the card will be great and the O2 will be buzzing.
No, I totally agree with you. And in my opinion, I think it's worth the box office, to be honest with you. I think it's going to be a great card.
I mean, like everything else, we have to be course, everyone, no one wants to pay, do they? My wife don't want to pay. She moans, so I'm used to it. I get it at home, never mind on social media. Yeah. But we have to be realistic. You know, there is an awful lot of money being thrown around in America, and we really want to keep a strong domestic base. Yeah. So we have to be competitive with that, because it's not fair on the fighter. You can't say you're boxing in England, box cheap. If you went to America, you'd get double. That just doesn't make sense. You lose all your talent that way. So therefore, we have to be competitive. And provided we put together a strong card, it's got to look outstandingly different from a Saturday night show. But then again, the Saturday night shows are getting stronger and stronger as well. So fight fans, you know, I think they've got to understand the fighter has to come first. It's not the promoter. It's not the TV broadcaster. Yes, we make a bit of money. Yes, Sky make a bit of money. But the real beneficiary is the fighter. And surely, if you love boxing, isn't that the most important thing out there?
I totally agree with you. Well, going back onto the WBC thing, like real quick. Now, from an outsider looking in, and I might have this totally wrong, so please put me in my place. But it seems to me that the governing bodies, WBC, WBA, etc., all have preferential promotional companies. For example, WBC and the PBC, and the WBO with Frank Warren and Bob Arum.
Yeah.
Well, do I read too much into that? Or?
I think you're probably right, but it shouldn't be that way. It should be on merit. But then again, we don't live in a perfect world, do we? So.
No.
If this, I mean, I go back to when Eubank was WBO champion, and I think, like, they were kind to us on occasions, you know. So,
yeah.
Realistically, if they're friends and if it keeps the organisation active and if they've got great fighters, I can understand that. But I don't think they should have too strong links with promotional companies at the expense of the integrity of boxing.
I totally agree with you. Now, going back on to your press conference yesterday, obviously there's been a little bit of, shall we say, comments here and there. Because of the slave trade, slave master.
Yeah, I don't really understand that, really, to be honest. I mean, I think people they take things out of context and they don't actually listen to what you say, because, I mean, the point I was making yesterday was how boxing, I mean, all sports changed in the 45 years I've been involved in it.
Yeah.
And boxing's probably changed more than almost any other sport. And the biggest change has been the power of the athlete, the talent.
Yeah.
You know, there's no question. You know, when we talk about slave trade, it is a colourful phrase.
Yeah,
I agree. But in the context of we were looking at, our fighters were promoted and managed yesteryear in comparison to how they act and react today.
Yeah.
Promotional contracts, manager contracts with boxers were very similar in a way to a type of slave trade agreement, because the promoter or manager had so much power and the boxer was actually told what to do. There was no question that the promoter was the employer and the boxer was the employee. And the point I was making yesterday was, refreshingly, and I'm delighted it's happened, delighted because I like fairness, nowadays the talent is king. The pendulum has swung away from the promoter having all the power to the boxer having all the power. Yeah. And that can only be a good thing. So I don't know what anyone got upset with yesterday, because there was certainly no slight on anyone involved. What it was a statement of the facts. And this all began, you know, actually I believe this began in the days of Chris Eubank and Lennox Lewis. I think two fighters that stood up for themselves and said, no, we want to be in charge. It's our career. It's our life. We want to be in charge. And what's happened, and I welcome that with Eubank very much, because we were very close. I got a percentage of what he got, but he owned the show. And that has been a trend that's continued, and I welcome it, because the fighters are the ones that put it on the line. We are servants of the fighter, not the other way round. But it used to be the other way around, hence my colourful reference. But people shouldn't get upset, but they should actually listen to what I'm saying instead of just going off on a tangent, because yesterday was a very good example. Dylan White owns the show at the O2.
Yeah.
Matchroom Sport work for Dylan White. Matchroom Sport are responsible for listening and getting Dylan White's approval and the approval of the Dylan White's team around everything connected with the show. And I find that refreshing, and other people should as well.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, for me, I took it as you were talking about all your fighters, all of Frank Warren's fighters, all of Don King's fighters, Bob Arum, not down to the race. It was just all of them.
No, it's nothing to do with it. I mean, In early days, people would sign young fighters for 6, 8, 10 fight deals. And obviously, if they progressed in their career, you'd probably say they sold themselves too cheaply.
Right.
And that's because the promoter had the control. If they got beat, then the deal would be renegotiated. But it was generally, and I am generalising, it was generally speaking, retrospective. You know, they were committed. And if you go back further beyond the Barry Earn, Frank Warren, Frank Maloney days, if you go back further in time, so many old fighters that I know you may have come across or read about retired with nothing because they never earned enough money. They got thrown in. They didn't have much control over their opponent, their training regime. It was very one-sided towards the people outside the four-cornered ring. Mm. Today's world, thank heavens, is completely changed. The slave trade concept, and again, that is a colourful phrase, but the concept of all the power being with the promoter has gone. And that can only be good news for the fight game, and it can only be good news for fighters who now can control their own destiny and actually make some money, change their life out of one of the most dangerous occupations there are.
Yeah, and I mean, for me, I mean, I think that a lot of the comments, we know where it is that they're coming from and the reasons for it. I think they understood exactly what it was that you were talking about.
Listen, to be honest with you, I'm so old, I don't really care. You know, all I can do is just call it as it is and tell you the truth. And the truth is, fighters are better off today. We're in a golden age of boxing. Yeah. TV companies around the world are throwing money out there because boxing's sexy. And most of it is down to, and I'll be biased, but I think the job that Eddie and his team have done have really upgraded the sport to a special occasion night, not just a fight for traditional fight fans.
Yeah.
And that is the good news why dozens of fighters now are making proper money. And they've always deserved it. But if you go and talk to old fighters that retired 20, 30 years ago, the stories are woeful in how they were treated in comparison to the superstars of today who call the shots. I mean, the AJs, the Tony Bellews, the Dylan Whites, these like the Amir Khans, the Kell Brooks, these guys are a major part of the business of boxing, not just in the ring, but outside the ring. And that can only be beneficial to the fight game and its future.
Totally agree. And the thing is, I mean, we've seen countless fighters suing former promoters and that, but I mean, correct me, but I don't think I've ever seen you already in the papers for being sued by a fighter for non-payment
We have a standard within Matchroom across 12 different sports, which we pride ourselves on. And, you know, you do get occasional disputes, you get disagreements, but we have never had any action taken against us for non-payment, for underpayment, for reneging on a deal. Yeah. It's just not our style. But I don't think we need to go on about that. People know our reputation. It's been built over 40 years, so
yeah,
it's not going to change now. But in the meantime, I think we should all calm down and look at what a great position boxing's in at the moment.
Yeah.
And when I watch kids like Dave, when I watch my friend the White Rhino, who I think the nation's warming to, and I see Big Pricey,
yeah,
it's so nice to know that they're getting paid properly.
Yeah. Although my mum always instilled to me, and which I heard you mention it as well, which is, I believe that's where my mum got it from, which was, whatever money you can, no matter what you do with it, make sure that you secure your house above all else.
That's what I think. There's a real working class thing that is, you know, as we all grew up from, you know, various, you know, council houses around the place or whatever. The dream was always pay off your mortgage, own a house. And I've always said to young fighters, first thing you do, pay off, because not many of them could have a chance to see beyond that. But even that is a massive, you know, a massive step forward for most people to actually own their own house. I mean, that's wonderful. Yeah. I mean, today some of them are going out and buying their own street or their own town, aren't they? They're making plenty. But they're only making it because the money's out there and because it's they've been promoted properly, they've promoted themselves properly, and they've won. And it's about, you know, it's a meritocracy. You've got to not just talk the talk, you know, you've got to walk the walk. You've got to do it in the ring. But when you do that, then you deserve to be paid properly.
Well, in addition to that as well, it means that fighters can retire on their terms as well.
Of course. I mean, I think, that, as I say, the pendulum has swung quite rightly in favour of the talent, which is the boxer, and he's the one without whom we would not be in business. So all power to their elbow.
And you carry that through to your snooker, your darts and all that kind of thing as well? And...
Yeah, of course, because life's too short, you know. I'd rather be entertained, you know. I want to see great nights. I want to have nice memories. And and I want to, if possible, we want to change lives if we can. And it's not the promoter, just the promoter doing it. It's a team. It's a team. Yeah. You've got to have that team mythology in your head. We're all pulling in the same direction. Yes, we want to make a living. Yes, they want to make a fortune. Yeah. That's fine. Most important of all is make sure we entertain the fans, make sure that the sponsors and the TV companies get value for money. No one will leave the table hungry.
Well, I mean, does it get to a point, though, with some of them where there's too much money in a sense of, I mean, I could never imagine anybody turning down, say, what Wilder done. Or $100 million for two fights back-to-back for Undisputed?
No, they've got advisors. They're, as I say, they should be in control of their own destiny, so they've made their decision for a reason. Perhaps they, one, don't fancy the fight. Mm-hmm. Two, maybe they think they can get more later on. Three, they've got other contractual issues, like they may be signed to a TV company that they don't want to leave or they don't want to upset. So there's lots of reasons for it. I mean, the secret is just to try your best and then you take what God gives you. You know, you can't force two people to fight each other. You can only make an offer and you need two people to agree.
Yeah.
In the case of Dillian White, he's had chances to fight Joshua. He's had times to fight. He's had his career mapped out in his mind and he knows where he wants to go. And we must respect that because if he keeps winning, he will be right. He will get better and better rewarded because that's the nature of boxing. You have to be famous, you have to keep winning, and your chance will come. That's the decision. That's, if you take Wilder Joshua, that's the risk that Wilder's taking. Maybe Fury's taking, I don't know. That's not mine to say, but they're taking the risk that the gravy train stops if they get beat before. You know, so there's always a risk, and that goes for Joshua as well. Does, you know, Joshua gets beat, it's a different conversation going forward, isn't it, for prospective fights. Deontay Wilder is, you know, it's a dangerous call. Amir Khan and Kell Brook have been avoiding each other for years, despite everyone's efforts to make it happen. And there's a danger that fight never happens if one of them gets beat from now onwards because it's actually getting smaller. It's still a big fight, but it's getting smaller than it was.
Yeah. Actually, while I've got you on the phone, I know the answer, but could you clarify for everyone, when it comes to boxing, Eddie is he's the top man, as in...
Top, of course.
Yeah.
Matchroom Sport is one of the world's biggest sports promotion companies.
Yeah.
It has interest in 12 different sports, and there's a group of about 150 people that are passionate about what they do, and each one has control of different areas.
Yeah.
The biggest at the moment is boxing, and that comes completely 100% under the control of Eddie.
Yeah.
I sit sort of at the top. I mean, I get roped in for the occasional press conference, which I think my next one will be in 10 years after yesterday. But I see it as the chairman and the owner of the company. I sit at the top and people report to me with their results in the same way as that any company would report to the holding company. But they are completely 100% in charge of their own destiny.
That's the thing, because I've seen like a lot of comments and I knew it wasn't true. Because like you said once that you wouldn't mind seeing the Joshua Wilder fight build for a little bit. And I understood what it was that you meant, but... I know a lot of the Joshua haters, Concorn haters, said that, see, it's Eddie's doing what Barry's told him to do because Barry's the boss in this.
No, only person that matters is not me or Eddie, it's AJ. That's right. And AJ wants the Wilder fight.
Yeah.
100% straight away. Yeah. What I'm telling you is commercially, and I'm generally rarely wrong on commercial terms, I've got a huge amount of experience. Generally speaking, fights like Wilder Joshua do get bigger, and they're certainly bigger now than they were 12 months ago when I made that remark. No question, is there?
Yeah. Definitely.
The market's changed. Once again, Bazza is 100% right. But it doesn't mean to say a fighter wants to fight someone, and sometimes that's all they focus on. Yeah. Joshua, quite rightly, wants to be the owner of four belts because he wants to be unified.
Yeah.
So the money is secondary. In some ways, it's secondary to Anthony Joshua because he's chasing a legacy.
Mm.
Now, whilst I respect that, it's my job also to advise him on the financial side of if you go this route or if you go that route.
Mm.
He is now committed, as we are committed, to making Joshua Wilder. But clearly, that has not yet convinced Mr. Wilder to fight Anthony Joshua, as we know. He's gone another route. Well, that's okay. That's risky. But he may be right as well. But when I said this fight this fight will be bigger in a year and bigger in 2 years.
Yeah.
In the same way as when Manny Pacquiao fought Floyd Mayweather, it was probably 3 years past their physical best.
Yeah.
But it was three times the fight in terms of money than when they were at their best, if that makes sense.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. No, I agree with you. I think that as long as these guys stay undefeated, of course.
Well, that's the risk, isn't it? That's the risk that they take and we take. But as I say, we're ready to push the button and go.
Yeah.
But it takes two to tango. So, and Josh's instructions are get me Wilder. I mean, can't make it clearer than that.
Yeah.
And even with Jarrell Miller having his problems and that fight not happening, Joshua's comment about replacements was, I'll fight anyone.
Yeah.
And he's very comfortable in his own ability, and he's a commercial man as well. He's, you know,
yeah.
Anthony Joshua is one of the smartest kids I've met, and I'm never anything less than very impressed with the way he handles himself. So no disputes there. But as I say, people have their own plans and their own schemes, and it's up to them. They're in charge of their destiny, like we said before, in a way the fighters from years ago never had the opportunity to be in control of theirs. And that overall is a very good thing.
No. I mean, for me, ideal scenario from my personal perspective is that for me, I would love it for Dillian to become WBC mandatory, fight Wilder, take that belt, and then he fight Joshua for Undisputed.
Yeah, great. I mean, it is an all-British fight, which is massive over here, but frankly, not yet massive in the States. They both need to be more famous in America, which I'm sure they will be in time.
Yeah.
I think Dillian White has an excellent opportunity to beat Deontay Wilder technically, so
yeah,
that would be great. And I think Dillian White deserves a world title.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whether that comes via, and Dillian would fight anyone as well, by the way,
yeah,
whether that comes via Deontay Wilder, Tyson Fury, or Anthony Joshua, providing Dillian keeps unbeaten, he will get his chance, and I think he believes enough in himself to think he's going to win any of those fights.
Mm.
It's exciting times. I mean, the fact that we're talking about it on the podcast and just rabbiting about boxing and other people around the country, around the world, more people are talking about boxing than ever talked about before. In my knowledge, I mean, I go back, you know, if you're going back to the Henry Cooper days, there was a big flavour around Henry, and that was a nice warm feeling. Frank Bruno, he was the nation's favourite, you know. We're right back up there, plus the fact that they're earning really substantial money. I mean, I bet you Frank, who's a gentleman, he's probably looking at some of these purses and thinking, bloody hell, I wish I was around now, you know, as they all will be. Any ex heavyweight out there is like, whoa. But then it's the same in football, isn't it? Premier League football, you know, you look at Premier League footballs of 5 years ago, 10 years ago, the world moves on. Money moves on in sport. People are prepared to pay for excellence.
Yeah.
And what we've done is created this wonderful British fight scene, which is now becoming a European fight scene and a world global fight scene. You know, with broadcasters around the world that share our enthusiasm, and the beneficiary is boxing and boxers.
Well, though, real quick, Lynn, my very first memory of boxing, Barry, was because of my dad. And it was actually you versus Frank Warren. It's actually my very first fight that I've seen live. And my dad hated you. He blamed you for the referee stopping his favourite fire in Barry McGuigan versus Jim McDonnell. You remember that one?
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah, I know. Well, I mean, Jim McDonnell was with me and Barry wasn't. But having said that, I did pay Barry McGuigan a lot of money, more so than anybody else would pay him. Yeah. I like Jim McDonnell, and Jim used to stay at my house, and we trained together, but no one was ever as fit as Jim McDonnell. Yeah. And that was a big night for us because he was our man and we won. But apologies to the McGuigan fans. Barry had plenty of days in the sunshine as well.
Yeah. No, it's good for me because me and my dad don't get on, so it's good for me. I enjoyed that. I enjoyed that. All right, Barry. So thank you very much for your time and clearing up everything. Hopefully people understand that it wasn't about race. The whole thing was about generalship back in the day.
Correct. Well done. Thanks for making it clear.
All right, buddy. You take care now.
Cheers, bro. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.